Some of the things in these how-to videos can be a bit dangerous. If you attempt anything, please be careful. Now let's get going.
Hey there, Maintenance Man fans. Today I am with Edie from Pine Daisy House, and she has done an awesome project that I'm pretty much just going to turn it over to her and let her tell you exactly what she did, how she did it, and we're just going to kind of talk about that, I guess.
Okay. So, sounds great.
But first, let's hear a little bit more about you. I've done one video for a fall kind of get your house ready for the winter video that went on your stuff. But tell everybody a little bit about Pine Daisy House first.
Yeah, absolutely. So like Patrick said, my name's Edie, and Patrick's actually my brother-in-law, so that's pretty fun that we're both in this creative space sharing just ways to make life better and to really create a thriving home that functions as productively as you can. So it's really fun to partner with Patrick from time to time. I live in Colorado in a modern cabin that was built in about 1979, and the layout of our home is very open, as you can see, and the main floor really creates this awesome cozy atmosphere that's very much a great room, with the kitchen being kind of the heart of the main floor. We've lived here for about 4 years, and the second year we lived here, we decided that it was time to start doing some updates to the house. One of them being just to do a little bit of an update and just kind of facelift in the kitchen. So originally, our kitchen was the same footprint, but the island, the cabinetry was identical to the cabinetry that you see behind. And so the base of the cabinetry has been updated, as well as the countertop. And it's always been my dream to have a really great rustic, kind of heavy, weighted island in a kitchen that just evokes kind of that rustic cabin living style that we love so much. And yet it's comfortable and it's inviting. And so this trapezoid island was one of the first things I saw when I walked into the kitchen and just fell in love with it and saw so much potential. So we're actually going to share, just show you guys a before of what it looked like. And when you see it, you'll see that it was really pretty brown. There was just no element in the kitchen that really grounded the kitchen and really set the kitchen apart in terms of its rustic nature and really the potential of what the home has as a whole. And so when we decided to give the kitchen a facelift, this was an easy decision to make. I did a lot of research on deciding what materials and what products I wanted to use on the island to give it the effect that I had. And I'm really excited to share that it cost $95 to do what I'm about to tell you. Yeah. And I did some research, absolutely, and ended up deciding to chalk paint the island. And so I'm just gonna kind of walk you through kind of my process, if that's okay.
Yeah.
And
yep.
If I miss anything, just chime in. This is absolutely your space, and you can probably think of things that I won't think of.
I'll ask you some
things. Yeah, absolutely. I live and hang out over on Instagram mostly and on my blog, so this is a really fun opportunity to share with Patrick's audience and just the YouTube population in general of how you can do something super easy, super effectively in the course of just a weekend. You know, if you're a weekend warrior project doer in your home, this is a really great project to tackle. I think so often homeowners are afraid to paint. They're really afraid to paint wood.
Yeah.
And the power of paint, it can't be understated. And so what I chose to do was I started with the island. And as you saw in that picture, I started with the countertop. The countertop is butcher block. It's a traditional butcher block. It's got a really soft edge that just kind of curves. It's not a really rough 90 degree hard edge at all. It's really soft. And just, it was wonderfully cozy, very appropriate for family life, but I really wanted to create a statement with our countertop. So my kids and I, on a long weekend, we sanded the polyurethane off the top of the butcher block just using a medium grit sandpaper and a hand sander. And we protected the range, so whatever range you have or whatever.
So you didn't pull the range out?
No, we didn't, because it was multiple people working, so.
Well, that's good to know, because if you don't want to pull the range out,
no,
I guess you don't
absolutely
have to, but make sure you're going to protect it.
This particular range is a glass top range that I adore. It's a six burner range, and it's nice and large, and so I was able to lift it slightly, put a sheet under the corners to protect the top, and then we were just very slow and very careful. And I obviously did most of the sanding around the range itself.
Right.
And so what I did is I just started on one end and I just sanded the polyurethane off the top. I just wanted, it was a sheen, there was a, it was a glossy poly top
sure.
to just give it back, get it back to its raw original state. And then the fun really started, and that's when the kids and I distressed the countertop. And so I have some of the materials that we use to distress it. And one thing I'm going to say is if you're going to distress anything, there's no wrong way to do it. It's actually super fun. The kids had a ton of fun. And I just wanted, I remember thinking, I want this to look like a piece of wood that was in a warehouse that had stuff dropped on it, or it was drug across a floor, it sat on the back of a flatbed, you know, for months and months and got weathered, and that's what I really wanted. So I used a few different things to create the distressed effect. And once you've got your wood down to its raw state, whatever wood you're working with, then I started to just go at it with chain.
So what do you mean go at it?
A rubber mallet. I just started to hit the...
Whipping it?
I just started to whip the wood with the chain, a rubber mallet, a hammer. And when I hit with the hammer, I created divots. And I created divots by just pushing and hitting and creating a movement, a forward movement, whatever direction I wanted to go. I also used a file to create some of the edging that you might see. Let's see where a good file spot is, but something like this where I wanted to create like some of that edging. And there, again, really no wrong way to do it. I had a really hardy nail that I grabbed in my hand and swiped across the top here and there as if something were being drug across the counter.
So if we can maybe kind of get a little closer to the table and look at some of these marks.
Absolutely.
So these longer ones here, these are created by your nail as you drug it. These, well, we haven't talked about that yet. These would be the chain, is that correct?
Absolutely. Then these are here, these divots here would be from the hammer. And what's really powerful is, we'll talk about it in a few minutes, but I used a dark wax after I distressed it, and that's when it really came to life and you really saw the movement. So as I was distressing prior to adding the dark wax, you couldn't really tell what I had done. But it wasn't until that dark wax was added that you could really see the life and the movement of what I had done with the kids.
So how do you get these lines that are going across here?
This is absolutely my favorite. So if you kind of focus in here for a second, you just take a wood screw and you take a traditional hammer and you hammer the wood screw into your wood, and it creates a really neat kind of distressed pattern throughout. Again, as if something were dropped on top of this wood or drug across the wood. And I just really loved that. Another element that you can see is, what did you call this, Patrick? Something special? With the way I sanded it, I went every direction with the sander, so it created a movement
in the grain.
What's
your sanders are orbital, or they're going to be linear, and you kind of want to watch for that, because the linear is going to put straight lines across it, and your orbital is going to do these little swirls that you can see on there. Just make sure you check out your sanders, because that's the pattern you're going to get. The heavier the grit you use, the deeper these grooves are going to be, and the way she did this, they're going to show up darker. The lighter your grit, obviously the smoother it's going to be, and I'm going to probably go so far as to say if you use too high of a grit, you're just going to turn it more of a cloudy than actually have texture to it. So you'll want to get a little more aggressive to make sure, I mean, chains and nails and files are aggressive. So make sure your sandpaper pattern, if you're going to have that in that, is going to match that same type of aggression.
And same idea here. I was really protective of the range. I have, our son is older, so he held the range up toward him while I distressed closer to where the range sits and lives.
You don't want to whip it with a chain.
You don't want to hit your glass top range with a chain, or you know, your gas range with a chain. Here's another really interesting aspect. So I had taken a nail and I had done a zigzag pattern on this side of the island. And after the fact, after I had added the dark wax, we went back over it with the sander to almost give it that we're trying to fix it, but yet it's not really getting fixed effect of what may have happened if it were an old collected, gathered piece in your home that's lived in multiple homes, in multiple spaces. And so we've got a couple spots on the island that that really
But it just added to it.
It added a lot of character. It added a lot of character. And we were nervous about it because we had had this super pristine, smooth surface, and then we ended with this. You have to be brave, for sure. But
yeah.
But I had this vision in mind. So once we got it distressed, we went back over it with a soft, lint-free cloth, and I used Annie Sloan Soft Wax Dark. And it's for painted furniture and in particular walls. It's a water-based wax, so what's really special about this particular wax, and it's a soft wax, I was just really able to apply it by hand, and if you look over here, there's areas where I deposited quite a bit of wax, actually, and left that there on purpose to give it almost like a wood grain look, and I really dug in the wax to all of the nooks and kind of crannies I had created through the distressing. And the curing did take some time because the type of wood I was working with was really, really dense. Remember, we were talking about that.
Yeah.
And honestly, start to finish, we were probably sitting around 4 weeks from start to finish to get it perfectly cured so that we could stand here, lean up against it, talk, all those things. But now, this is 3 years later, and it still looks rich and has movement and has life to it that... is still really a storied piece, which is really fun to share about. A couple of things that you can keep in mind with this particular product is, it's water-based. So when I clean this surface, I just use a damp cloth and I gently wipe. I don't really work into the surface because if I do, I'm going to work up some of the wax. But the beautiful thing is, if it gets to the point where some of the wax gets worked up, to the point where it's too light for me, I'll just come over and add more dark wax. This is a great example on this side of the island. I'm actually just gonna move this over. This section of the island is starting to get lighter in comparison to other corners. And so probably within the next year to 18 months, I'm gonna be applying more dark wax to make it match. And that's just part of living with this DIY piece that I knew in advance and was completely comfortable doing.
Yeah, it definitely needs, I mean, every home needs maintenance. Everything needs to be kept up. You got to clean things, you got to refresh things. And this, I say, would probably, and I'm going to wager a guess, is probably pretty easy to come back after the fact, mash things up, and take care of it. Don't have to redo the whole project or anything. You can.
And the beautiful thing is, if you don't like it and you don't like how dark it is, wipe it off.
Yeah, water based.
It's water based. So when I want to go to disinfect my wood surface, I just take a disinfectant wipe and just gently wipe the top of it really carefully. Our kids live up here. We eat breakfast daily up here. We do homework on this surface. It's just a piece that we live with, and that was what I wanted, was something that had so much life for this room, but then we could add life to it. Our son set a cookie sheet down and burned a spot over here, but it doesn't matter because it just adds to the character of the piece.
Yeah, living on it's definitely going to help it.
Absolutely. It was so much fun. It's probably been my favorite DIY project we've done, and we've done a lot in our cabin, but it's my absolute favorite that we've done. And just to wrap things up, I want to share about how I painted the base, if that's okay.
Yeah, talk about the whole island.
Absolutely. So it's a trapezoid-style island. There's integrated storage on the back side, and then under here where the bar space is are two corbels, as well as just, you know, a place for the children to sit or company to enjoy a breakfast buffet. So I chose to paint the entire base, including the corbels and that light molding there, Annie Sloan chalk paint graphite, which kind of has a little bit of a blue undertone to it, as you can see. I chose to keep the foot brown, again, to just give it grounding and give it a base and ground it to the room. I could have easily painted, you know, even more closer to that floor molding there. It was just personal preference. There's really no right or wrong way to do it when it's, you know, your home. Once I painted it, I did a wet distress. Now, wet distressing is really pretty easy. You just take, again, a damp cloth. Right before your paint has fully set, and you just go to certain spots and you add that character and that distressing that you can see. So I'm actually gonna come down here and show you. So there's some wet distressing that I did just where, again, I wanna create character and movement here with the corbels, as if someone were, you know, kicked the island while they were sitting here, or something got scratched across the island or something. So So this got wet distressed. Then I let it completely set. And I did that actually for the entire
All the
way around. I wet distressed, you know, corners, places that I knew would naturally have a rubbing to them. And then, actually, I think you could probably come around to this corner and you'll really be able to see. Once it hits completely set, you might be able to get a little bit of shine from just the light. You can see I did some distressing here, just places where, you know, it would naturally rub. You know, if you were thinking this is an old piece in your kitchen or an old piece in your home. And then at the very, very end, once it had completely set, I added Annie Sloan Clear Wax just to give it a slight sheen, a little bit of depth, because I had removed all the movement that the wood grain added. I wanted to add a little bit more just kind of polish to it. And the clear wax goes on exactly like the dark wax does. It's just with a soft, lint-free rag that's dry, and you just rub it in. And the more you rub it, the shinier it gets. And it's water-based, so as it starts to wear off, you can just add more.
Yeah, so you mentioned that you wet distressed it with a cloth. Mm-hmm. Is there technique to the cloth?
I think, you know, a really nubby cloth, like a utility cloth you might find, you know, at just a local hardware store where you've got sort of like paint supplies and things like that. Just a really nubby old washcloth for your bathroom that's seen some years. Maybe it's got tears in it. I just dampened it under the kitchen sink and used that. You can also dry distress. Once it's a little bit too dry to wet distress, you can just take that medium grit sandpaper, just walk over it, and just use whatever discretion you want as the designer of your piece to say, yeah, I think there would be natural weathering here, so I'm going to distress this and rub a little bit of the paint off with this sandpaper or a slightly wet cloth. It takes a little bit of elbow grease, but it really worked well.
Sure. So what would you say was the absolute hardest part of the entire project?
I think really the hardest part of the project was probably painting the base of the island.
Sure.
We chose not to paint the interior of the cabinets. That was a decision that I made just out of time. But absolutely, ideally, when you paint cabinets, you're taking cabinets off, you're wiping them off, you're doing that, all of that. This is a really, the house was built in the late 70s, so I actually chose not to take the cabinets off because they are original to the house. I didn't want to risk stripping the screws
out.
And
yep.
Messing up with the hardware. So I kept the cabinetry on, and over time and as years go by, the plan is to, if we ever sell the house, to finish it off. You know, it's that whole 95 percenter. I'm almost finished with it, but
yeah.
really, it's fine. It doesn't bother us that the inside of the cabinets aren't painted. Right. There's just a lot of little nooks and crannies you don't want to miss, especially if you do two coats. Annie Sloan went on really, really well. I will say this product encourages a specific type of paintbrush. It's certainly not required. Chalk painting does encourage that you use a special chalk paint brush. It's certainly not required, but I would say I borrowed the chalk paint brushes, which kept my costs down. Had I bought them, it would have increased the cost, but you can go, you know, you don't have to buy that particular line, but if you choose to, they're a really great investment to make, especially if you're gonna chalk paint other pieces, because the chalk paint brushes are really dense.
Yeah, when I've done chalk painting in the past, my wife loves to do that. Mm-hmm. We've always just used a boar hair brush. Mm-hmm. They're pretty cheap, but that's not necessarily the end result that Annie's wants you to have. Mm-hmm. So yeah,
absolutely.
Definitely.
And so following the directions on the back of the paint cans, using the recommended products is always the way to go, because what's special about those brushes is it really gives you an even coat and you actually use a significant amount less product. So your product goes much further.
Sure.
I've used all three of those products on multiple projects in our house and have been thrilled with the results. And they're still in incredible shape, 3 years old. And so I know if I need more dark wax, exactly where it is, and I've got plenty to spare. A little goes a long way with chalk paint and wax that goes with chalk paint. So starting with less and adding more is absolutely your favorite. But I would say the hardest part was definitely the cabinet element, because, you know, you're crouched down. It's just physically more intense than standing up here adding the wax. And as a quick side note, as I'm just processing through the project, I did choose to dark wax under the cabinet, or under the counter. There is a little bit of a lip because it's a bar. And when I walked up the stairs, having the underside be the original light colored butcher block did not flow at all. So I chose to just do a real light wax. I did not sand it. I put it right on top because the underside didn't have that clear coat of polyurethane. And the beauty of chalk paint is you put it right on top of what's going on. You don't have to sand it. You don't, you know, I did gentle cleaning of the cabinetry in advance, but I didn't have to do any sanding to the cabinets when I painted them, which is great.
Yeah. Well, what an awesome addition to the house. What a way to take something that was obviously fine, but to make it your own. So be brave, be bold.
Yeah.
You know, guys, I hope that this helps you out. I'm going to put links down below to the product, to a lot of stuff at Pine Daisy House.
I did write a blog post, and like I said, I live and hang out on Instagram, and on my blog, I did write a blog post about this, and so we'll put that in the description.
Yep.
Products in the description, and also just ways to get in touch with me.
Yeah, if you guys have questions specifically on this one, this project, and how to do it, I'm going to defer to Edie on them. Mm-hmm. So if you want to leave a comment below, I will either pass it along to her, give her access to all that, but we'll get your questions answered, so don't hesitate to ask.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you can contact her directly and just talk to her about it. We'll leave maybe an email or a way to contact
handle,
through Instagram.
Any of that is that'll all be there. We'll make sure you can get in touch. And it's a really fun element and aspect and design piece to our cabin. And I think it sets the tone for the whole entire home, because of just the character and the nature of it. And it was a risk for sure. It was kind of scary. You gotta be brave and you just gotta trust your design gut sometimes. And there have been a couple of projects on our cabin that I've done that with, and I'm so glad I did.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much.
Thanks.
It's been great, it's been fun.
This is really fun to do. Yeah, we'll have to do it more.
Yeah, we'll definitely do some more stuff. Hey guys, if you like what you see on Ask the Maintenance Man, go ahead and subscribe, click the notification bell, give this video a thumbs up, and thanks for watching.
Yep, bye.